The Russian Empire at the time of the revolution was in the process of industrializing, but was still overwhelmingly an agrarian society. And yet, within the space of only a few decades of the founding of the Soviet Union, it had transformed itself into an industrial powerhouse. So, how did this happen? Where did this happen? And what were the effects of this industrialization? I'm your host, David, and today we are going to take a look at this industrialization process in the Soviet Union with a special focus on Ukraine as one of the key centers of development. This is the Cold War. So, the new Soviet Union, properly established in 1922, quickly recovered industrial production to its pre-First World War levels. But as positive as this sounds, through the 1920s, it still lagged significantly behind the European industrial powerhouses like Britain, Germany, and France. They produced less steel, less iron, less electricity, less oil, and less coal than the nations they saw as their adversaries. But once Stalin had risen to power, he deemed this gap one of the country's most pressing issues. And at the 14th Congress of the All-Union Communist Party in December of 1925, he proclaimed a course of industrialization. Stalin saw the lack of industrial capacity in the Soviet Union as a threat to the country's military potential and was convinced that this weakness would be exploited by the enemies of the Soviet Union in the coming inevitable war. On February 4, 1931, he made a speech to an assembly of Soviet industrial managers where he criticized chronic Russian underdevelopment as one of the reasons for its historical defeats. She, Russia, was beaten by the Mongol Khans. She was beaten by the Turkish Beys. She was beaten by the Swedish feudal lords. She was beaten by the Polish and Lithuanian gentry. She was beaten by the British and the French capitalists. She was beaten by the Japanese barons. All beat her because of her backwardness, because of her military backwardness, cultural backwardness, political backwardness, industrial backwardness, agricultural backwardness. They beat her because to do so was profitable and could be done with impunity. Such is the law of exploiters, to beat the backward and the weak. It is a jungle law of capitalism. That is why we must no longer lag behind. Do you want our socialist fatherland to be beaten and to lose its independence? If you do not want this, you must put an end to its backwardness in the shortest possible time and develop a genuine Bolshevik tempo in building up its socialist economy. There is no other way. That is why Lenin said on the eve of the October Revolution, "Either we perish or overtake and outstrip the advanced capitalist countries." We are 50 or 100 years behind the advanced countries. We must either make good this distance in 10 years, either we do it or we shall go under. Stalin personally doubled down on the rhetoric of the inevitability of war and the need to prepare for it. He took advantage of the totalitarian propaganda machine at his disposal to instill a siege mentality in the Soviet population. Either we work harder than ever and build tanks and airplanes or the bloody capitalists will get us, type of thing. So the Soviet industrialization campaign was not one for improving the lives of the Soviet people, but rather to improve and enhance its military potential. The resulting industrial campaign that developed focused on the following primary aspects. 1. Ensuring the economic independence of the Soviet Union. 2. Overcoming the industrial and economic backwardness of the country. 3. Establishing the technological basis for the modernization of Soviet agriculture through factories, building tractors, and other agricultural machinery. 4. Increasing the urban proletarian population of the country. And 5. Demonstrating the advantages of the socialist system over that of the capitalist system. Now, through the 1920s and into the 1930s, the Soviet Union, despite the growth that it had experienced during the period of the new economic policy, was economically weak and isolated on the global stage. This raised questions and complications on how to obtain and allocate resources for such a huge project across such an enormous state. The Soviet solution was to prioritize heavy industry over light industry and the food industry. It meant the sale of natural resources like oil, gas, grain, wood, and fur for cheap prices to available buyers. The Soviet government claimed valuable cultural artifacts like art and sold them abroad. They also took advantage of free volunteer labor of workers on Saturdays and Sundays, called the Subotniks and Voskresniks, as well as the free labor of the expanding prison system. And all of this against a general regime of economic austerity. But it wasn't just a lack of resources that needed to be overcome. There was a human capital shortage as well, namely a lack of qualified personnel capable of implementing and then managing the growing industrial capacity of the Soviet Union. On top of this was a general lack of developed transportation infrastructure. In the face of these problems, the Soviet government applied the best method it had in order to overcome the problems. They forced the population to work extremely hard for extremely long hours. There was, after all, nobody better at forcing and manipulating people to do just that than good old Uncle Joe. So, that was the general situation. Now, as promised, let's take a closer look at Ukraine, which became one of the key industrial regions of the Soviet Union. The overall situation in Soviet Ukraine by mid-1920s was similar to the rest of the USSR. Weak infrastructure and a lack of qualified workers and engineers, but with lots of potential, both in agriculture as well as industry. The energy potential of the Dnipro River, as well as the coal reserves of the Donbas, were looked at as key for future development. A quick note regarding geography, as this becomes very important later. Most of the natural resources relevant for industrialization were located in the east and the southeast of Ukraine, making those areas the key focus for Soviet development and investment. Donbas and the lower Dnipro already had some industrial development, and it logically made sense to continue to expand this. The right bank, western Ukraine, was largely an agricultural region, something which would remain in place. But Moscow also saw western Ukraine as a, quote, potential theater of war in the event of conflict with Poland or Germany, end quote. As such, there was less desire to develop industry there for fear of it being captured or destroyed in the inevitable war to come. 1928 saw the first five-year plan and real start of Soviet industrialization. The target was to increase heavy industrial production by 330%. Certainly a lofty goal, but as Ukraine was recognized to have the most potential, it was deemed achievable. But even so, one-third of all state capital investment for the five-year plan was dedicated to Ukraine. The aim was to build 1,500 facilities across the Soviet Union, with 400 of them in Ukraine. Provided targets were met, this was supposed to result in an annual increase in industrial production of 20 to 22% per year. The first year saw growth targets met, with gross output of Ukrainian industry increased by 20%. Keep in mind, this was at a time where the capitalist world was just about to enter an economic crisis. The tangible growth rates in the Soviet Union helped to create the impression that the industrialization efforts in the USSR would close the gap between it and the West. In November of 1929, at the plenum of the Central Committee, a decision was adopted to enhance the pace of mechanical engineering in other fields of heavy industry at all costs. The goal was to further boost industrial output by 45% in 1930-31. The program was called Shturm auf China, working harder and more. Investment in the Ukraine SSR was increased from 438 million rubles in 1929 to 1.2 billion rubles in 1932. However, despite this massive increase, the goals of the five-year plan went unrealized. This was the result of its extremely ambitious goals and the lack of qualified workers, especially engineers, additionally exacerbated by the famine created across large parts of agricultural Ukraine and Russia. The combination of these things led to regular accidents and general disorder. In true Soviet fashion, the problems were blamed on diversions and sabotage by enemies of the people. The results for the first five-year plan were unflattering. Enough so that the Politburo refused to allow the publication of the real statistics. Official numbers for Ukraine indicated that the first five-year plan was met in 4 years and 3 months, but the real numbers indicated that 23.7% growth that had been realized in 1929 had dropped to only 5% by 1933. The average annual increase in industrial output didn't exceed 10% over the time period. Of course, the first five-year plan had a sequel, the creatively named second five-year plan. With more realistic goals, it aimed for an annual industrial growth rate of 16.5% and even included some development of light industry. Like the first five-year plan, Ukraine was a prime benefactor of the program. Of the 4,500 new factories to be built, 1,000 of them would be in Ukraine, although there was more diversification to other regions of the USSR, including the Urals, the Kuznets Basin, and the Volga region, well away from the expected European conflict area. This diversification meant that while the Ukraine SSR was receiving 18.3% of total capital investments in the USSR in 1933, that dropped to 13.5% by 1939. Now, like the first plan, the second one was declared complete in advance of the deadline. However, in reality, only 70 to 77% of the plan was actually met. But despite this shortcoming, the progress being made was most apparent. By the eve of the Great Patriotic War, the Ukraine SSR was responsible for one-fifth of all industrial output in the Soviet Union. It produced 63% of its iron ore, 50% of its coal, 61% of its cast iron, 47% of its steel, 47% of all agricultural machines, and 25% of its electrical power. These are huge numbers in key industries, and while a third five-year plan was started, the German invasion in 1941 obviously prevented its completion. And what was the real-world impact of the first two plans? Well, despite neither having actually completed their stated targets, the industrialization process likely helped to deliver the Soviet Union's eventual victory over the Axis. It allowed for the mass production of modern military vehicles and equipment, including both tanks and aircraft, instrumental for the Red Army. Built in the Ukraine since the start of the first five-year plan were such things as the Dnieper hydroelectric station, for a time the largest hydroelectric station in Europe. Also completed were the Krivorozhye, Kyiv, and Kharkiv hydroelectric stations. 53 new coal mines were established, 12 blast furnaces opened, and 24 open hearth furnaces established. Icons of Soviet industry were completed, like the Kharkiv tractor plant, the Lysychansk chemical plant, the Novokramatorsk heavy machine building plant, the Komunar agricultural machine building plant in Zaporozhye, as well as the Zaporozhstal and Krivozhstal metal and steel works, and the now more than famous Azovstal metal and steel works. This list is certainly not exhaustive either, but does highlight the rapidity and the scale of the building projects which were being undertaken. And none of it was possible without the extremely hard work being forced on the people. In order to keep workers motivated, competitions were organized between groups of different organizations performing similar work. Coal miners in the Donbass competed against miners in the Kuzbass or in Moscow Oblast. Construction workers from Dnipropetrovsk competed against construction workers building the Turkestan-Siberian Railway, and so on. From this came the Udarniki, the exemplary workers who completed their assigned plans earlier than they were scheduled to. In Ukraine, there were over 350,000 Udarniki, who the Soviet propaganda machine glorified, taking notable workers and making them icons of the labor movement. In 1932, the USSR heard about Nikita Izitov, a worker from Horlivka who completed 10 times his work quota in a single day. And then there was, of course, the most famous of them all, Alexei Stakhanov. Stakhanov, a miner, extracted 102 tons of coal in a single day, overfilling his daily quota by 14.5 times, according to the propaganda about him anyway. But like anything in life, these successes came at a price. In these situations, the trade was made in the living standards of the Soviet people. Ration cards were imposed, there was a deficit of consumer goods, and as discussed in our recent episodes on Soviet housing, workers moving to urban areas were forced to live in barracks and packed dormitories, which had very poor hygienic standards. Now, during the Great War, Germany occupied Ukraine, and much of the work that had been done over the preceding 10 to 15 years was destroyed. But not all of it. Some was managed to be evacuated eastwards, including the Novokramatorsk heavy machine building plant and the Kharkiv tractor plant. With the conclusion of the war and Ukraine back under Soviet control, one of the most pressing issues facing the government in Moscow was rebuilding the country and its industrial capacity. As such, as the war ended, the Soviet people were put back to work. Official records show the industrial output for 1945 at only 25% of the 1940 level. For 1946, the fourth five-year plan was introduced. It allocated 19.3% of capital investment for Ukraine and put the focus on heavy industry. Specifically, it paid attention to restoring the coal mining and metallurgy industries in Donbas, iron ore production in Krivorozhye, and the metallurgy industry on the left bank of the Dnipro. The results from the fourth five-year plan were impressive. 380 new mining headframes were built, 700 new lifting machines were produced, 1,000 kilometers of tunnels dug, and 5.5 million square feet of industrial buildings constructed just in Ukraine. By 1948, the Novokramatorsk machine building plant had regained its pre-war capacity, the Kharkiv tractor plant was producing at pre-war levels, and the October Revolution plant at Voroshilovgrad had been turning out ships. 1948 also saw the completion of the Dyshava-Kiev pipeline, the largest natural gas pipeline in Europe at the time, and one that would go on to supply gas to not only Kyiv, but Moscow as well. By June of 1950, the Dnipro-Gres power plant had been restored and renovated, while at the same time, railway capacity in the Republic was being measured at 17% above pre-war levels. This is also when large sulfur deposits were found in the Carpathians, which would lead to a significant chemical industry being established in Ukraine. By the end of the fourth five-year plan, Ukraine was producing 40% of all Soviet steel, 50% of its iron ore and its cast iron, as well as one-third of its coal. It had resumed its position as the highest producer of blast furnaces, agricultural equipment, mining machinery, energy compensators, and pipes and metal in the Soviet Union. All told, the pace of machine building was 144% of the pre-war period. So the net effect from this reindustrialization was that by 1957, the Ukrainian SSR was a highly industrialized republic, providing 19% of Soviet gross product, worth approximately 174 billion rubles. As you would expect, though, the law of diminishing returns began to kick in. Although industrialization continued, growth began to slow down, especially in the years after 1965. By the time of the 11th five-year plan, which started in 1981, Ukrainian industry was growing by a comparatively paltry 3.5%. Of course, that's 3.5% growth on a much larger base, so still a fairly impressive number. Included in the industrial achievements of the Ukrainian SSR in the post-Stalin period was the construction of 5 water reservoirs on the Dnipro River and the construction of 4 nuclear power plants, including the ill-fated plant at Chernobyl. By the eve of the Soviet collapse in 1991, industry in Ukraine was manufacturing products for almost 300 different fields and was a major producer of Soviet electricity, coal, and iron ore. The Republic, particularly the eastern part of the country, had grown into a main center of Soviet industry, built on the backs of the Herculean efforts and terrible working and living conditions of the 1920s and 1930s. But it would be dangerous to characterize this industrial juggernaut as being able to stand on its own. It was fully integrated into the overall Soviet economy, and Ukrainian industry relied on other Soviet regions and industries for both supplies and purchasers. For example, the construction of the Terebliya-Ryskaya hydroelectric plant required the use of tractors from Stalingrad, bulldozers from Chelyabinsk, transporters from Kazakhstan, pumps from Uzbekistan, and different other tools and equipment from Lithuania, Latvia, and Estonia. Likewise, the resources and products produced in Ukraine were sold across the Soviet Union and onwards to the global socialist world. When the Soviet Empire collapsed in 1991 and new countries cut their economies off from each other, or at the very least, imposed new tariff and trade conditions, these interdependencies collapsed with it. This led to the very difficult transition period of the 1990s and even beyond, where economies shrunk, unemployment and underemployment soared, and nostalgia for the good old days grew. But all of this is subject material for future episodes. We hope you've enjoyed this episode, and to make sure you don't miss our future work, please make sure you're subscribed to our channel and have introduced the 16th five-year plan for pressing and the growth of the People's Bell button. Please consider supporting us on Patreon at patreon.com/thecoldwar or through YouTube membership. We can be reached via email at thecoldwarchannel@gmail.com. This is the Cold War Channel, and as we think about the Cold War, I will leave you with the words of JFK. In the final analysis, our most basic common link is that we all inhabit this small planet. We all breathe the same air, and we all cherish our children's future. And we are all mortal.